measurement of vacuum. So, till now we saw atmospheric pressure, total pressure. So, now we have gone into measurement of vacuum. So, in measurement of vacuum, pressure below atmosphere are generally termed as low pressure or vacuum pressure below the atmosphere. When the term vacuum is mentioned, it means that the gauge pressure is negative. This is very important. So, when the gauge pressure is negative, it is called as vacuum. However, atmospheric pressure serves as a reference and absolute pressure is positive. Low pressure are more difficult to measure than medium pressure. So, I told you anything which is higher in pressure, it is easy. If you want to go, this is atmospheric pressure. So, anything lower than that is always a difficult. Maglot gauge, which is also known as a compression gauge, is used for vacuum measurement by compressing the low pressure gas whose pressure is to be measured. The tapped gas get compressed in a capillary tube. The vacuum is measured by measuring the height of the column of mercury. So, this is how the setup looks like. So, you have a bulb, you have a capillary which is attached, then you have a vacuum source which is attached. So, here you have graduations, this is capillary A, then you have B, then you have C. C is a moving resource and here is the opening you have, opening O you have, vacuum is applied here, you try to measure. So, Maglot gauge works on Boyle's law, which states that by compressing a known volume, suppose you have a football filled with air, so you compress. Compressing a known volume of low pressure gas to a higher pressure, compressing the volume of a low pressure gas to higher pressure, initial pressures can be calculated by measuring the resulting volume and pressure. That was Boyle's law. So, the fundamental relationship is P1 is equal to, so this is P1 V1 equal to P2 V2. So, they have considered as P1 equal to P2 V2 by V1. So, if V is the volume of the bulb in capillary A above the level O, P1 is the unknown pressure of the gas in the system connected to B and C. If you go back and see, connected to B, pressure B and C. P2 is the pressure of the gas in the limb after compression and V2 is the volume of the gas in the sealed limb after compression. Then P1 V1 equal to P2 V2. If the cross section area of the capillary tube is A and the difference in the level of the two columns in limb B and A and B is H, then V2 equal to A into H. H is the difference of P1 P2, that is H P2 minus P1. Therefore, we can put it back into the equation P1 V1 equals to P2 A H, which is nothing but V2. So, now we try to re-alter the equations. We try to make P1 V1 equal to H plus P1 into A H. So, we re-alter the terminologies. So, A H2 plus A H P1. So, now we move this P1 here. So, P1 taking common as V1 minus A H equal to A H2. The ratio of V1 to A is called as the compression ratio. V1 to A is called as the compression ratio. A is made too small, the mercury tends to stick inside the capillary tube. This imposes a restriction on the upper limit of the compression ratio. So, A cannot be very small. So, if it is very small, the system fails. So, P1 is equal to A H2 minus V1 minus A. So, this terminology comes and we try to remove this A H is less than V1. So, with this we can try to measure the vacuum pressure. The other one is called as the Pirani gauge. The principle on which a Pirani gauge works is thus when a heated wire is placed in a chamber of gas, thermal conductivity of the gas depends on its pressure. Very important, Pirani gauge is used for very low vacuum, and that too in a sophisticated instruments we always use Pirani gauge. Pirani gauge, when a heated wire is placed in the chamber of gas, the thermal conductivity of the gas depends on its pressure. Hence, it follows the energy transfer from the wire to gas is proportional to the gas pressure. This is very efficiently used even today. The temperature of the wire can be altered by keeping the heating energy supplied to the wire constant and varying the pressure of the gas, thus providing the method of pressure measurement. I repeat, this is one of a very important gauge which has even now finds application, where the working principle is when a heated wire is placed in the chamber, heated wire in a chamber, the thermal conductivity of the gas depends on the pressure. Three attributes, namely magnitude of current, resistivity of the current and the rate at which the heat is dissipated, governs the temperature for a given wire through the electric current flow. A resistance bridge is employed when the resistance of the two filament is measured. The bridge is balanced at some reference pressure and the out of balance current are used at all the other pressures as the measurement of relative pressure. This is also very, very important. The bridge is balanced at some reference pressure and the out of balance current are used at all other pressures as the measurement of the relative pressures. So, this is how a Pirani gauge, a vacuum source is there, a bridge circuit is there, this is the filament which is heated. So, you apply a constant heat, try to measure, or you try to change the heat, measure the voltage, anything is fine. So, Pirani gauge with compensation to ambient temperature, you can see here a vacuum is there. So, here is a heated one, the output of the heated one is attached to a voltmeter and then it is attached to another heated element. So, this gauge is, this is a sealed evacuated gauge. So, you have resistance built and this is the applied voltage. So, you see this Pirani gauge with compensation for ambient temperature change. Next is ionization gauge. Ionization gauge are employed for medium and high vacuum measurement. These gauges convert neutral gas molecules into positively charged or ionized gas molecules. What is ionization? I take two potentials, maybe positive, negative, put it inside a container and keep applying electricity. So, here what happens? The ionization happens. Okay. So, when the gas converts the neutral gas molecule into positively charged or ionized gas molecule, this is used. The gauge is also known as thermionic gauge, as electrons are emitted from the heated filament. This is a filament or substance. The emitted electrons are known as thermions, thermally emitted ions, thermions. The principle of thermion emission is employed in electron vacuum tubes. When the tungsten filament is heated at a very high temperature, passing very high current, the electrons acquire sufficient energy and move into the space. The hot cathode ionization gauge, the electron emits from the thermionic cathode will be accelerated in the electric field. So, what we are trying to say, this is negative, this is positive. So, this is inside a vacuum and you apply lot of voltage, right, voltage or current. So, there is ionization happening. This ionization can spread everywhere. So, what I do is I try to put a magnetic coil around it or an electric field and make sure that they are focused. These electrons collide with the gas molecules and ionize them. The anode and the grid are at negative and positive potential respectively with reference to the filament. The gas molecules collide with the electron emitted from the heated filament and becomes ionized. the positive ions move towards the negatively charged anode, thus the ionization current flow through the circuit, which is measured as absolute gas pressure in the gauge. So, the absolute gas pressure can be defined as Kc I1 by I2. So, this is what is I1, this is I2, K is a factor. So, you have an anode, you have a cathode, here is a grid which is otherwise called as a bias, we apply, and here is a vacuum. As long as the potential and the grid circuit current or the electronic current remains unchanged, the absolute gas pressure will be proportional to the ionization current. The filament used in triode assembly is made of pure or thyrated tungsten or platinum alloy coating of barium and strontium oxide. So, these are the materials which are used for the vacuum measuring gauge. The another gauge is called as Knudsen gauge. It is a device employed to measure very low pressures. The pressure measured is a function of a net rate of exchange of momentum of molecular density between the vane and the hot plate, which are at different temperatures. So, this is the principle with which the Knudsen gauge works. The pressure is measured as a function of net rate of exchange of momentum of molecular density between the vanes of a pump and the hot plate, at which are kept at different temperatures. This in turn can correlate the pressure and temperature of the gas. Okay, so, let me draw the figure so that you will have a better understanding. This will be the suspension of filament. Okay. So, here is this is plate 1. This is vane 1, okay, and this is vane 2, plate 2, plate 2, vane 2, the top one, and here I attach plate here and plate here. Okay. So, the plate 1 is behind, this is behind plate 1 is behind, and here plate 2 is forward and vane is behind. Okay. So, here there is a mirror, and this in turn has a graduation scale, this is a scale. So, this is how a Knudsen gauge works. The angular displacement of the mirror is measured of the net momentum force. Where is the mirror? So, this is the mirror. Okay. So, mirror is measured of the net momentum F imparted on the vanes due to the difference in the velocities. So, the equation for the gas pressure is given as P equal to 4 times F Tg by T minus Tg. So, T minus Tg is the difference in temperature. Okay. F is the momentum force, net momentum force, and P is the pressure change. Tg is the vane temperature. Vane temperature. Okay. So, the main advantage of Knudsen gauge are that it gives absolute pressure and does not need any calibration. They are very high pressure, they are very useful at very high pressure environments. High pressure measurements necessitate the use of specific devices. The most popular device used is Bridgman's gauge, which can measure high pressure up to 1 lakh atmosphere. The conventional bridge circuit are employed for measuring the change in resistance, which is calibrated in terms of applied pressure, which is given by the equation of this. Right, the Bridgman requires frequent calibration as aging is a problem. Okay, and in the previous one, Knudsen's gauge, there is no calibration required at all. A fluid flow measurement, till now what we saw was only air as a media. Now we will try to see fluid. A fluid flow measurement, measuring the speed of a flow can be done by timing the progress of a surface floats. The average speed of flow can be calculated approximately from the surface speed. For example, if the water is flowing and on top of it you put a small paper and you time it, okay, now it starts and then you take for after 100 meters the velocity of the water. So, that is what we are trying to say. The speed of flow can be done by timing the progress of a surface floats. The average speed of flow can be calculated approximately from the surface speeds. The salt gulp injection method, which requires only a small quantity of salt solution, a handheld conducting meter and a stopwatch, we can do it. So, the measured quantity is V suffix U of salt solution is made up typically a few liters from a river, small river, perhaps 1 liter or less of stream. So, the conductivity is this. So, and the reading conductivity are taken at time intervals T, say 5 seconds and 10 seconds, we try to calculate the flow. So, the flow can be given by this equation. This is a very simple flow equation, where conductivity of the solution is measured as Cu, velocity is Vu, right, and then Ci and C naught. Ci is the reading in the conductivity and C naught is the background level which is there. So, with this we try to calculate Q. The use of ultrasonic method for flow monitoring, this consists of setting up an ultrasonic transducer and a receiver across the flow, with the equipment on one side of the river being downstream of that of the other side. So, we see the velocity with which the amplitude travel, the velocity with which the sound travels and comes back. So, with the pitch and catch, we can try to figure out what is the velocity, right. When the sound wave is transmitted from the upstream to the downstream station, the sound wave travels faster than going from downstream to upstream. The time difference is used to calculate the water speed. There are number of possible errors which can happen in this, but still people do it for a ballpark figure. Steady flow in a pipe, this is the very common experiments where fluid mechanics people do. The pressure drop is a function of speed squared, hence a mean steady reading represents a mean value of the speed squared, while the average flow depends on the mean speed, not squared. So, to recapitulate what we saw in this particular lecture is pressure measurement, type of manometers, type of transducers, types of gauge and measurement of vacuum. There is a flow measurement also there, but we are restricting ourselves up to vacuum. The content of this lecture is going to be pressure measurement, type of manometers, different types of transducers, type of gauges and measurement of vacuum. Thank you.